Welcome to our Azure Incident Retrospective. I'm David Steele.
I'm Sami Kubo. We work in the Azure Communications team.
In addition to providing a written post-incident review after major outages, we also now host these retrospective conversations.
You're about to watch a recording of a live stream where we invited impacted customers through Azure Service Health to join our panel of experts in a live Q&A.
We had a conversation about reliability as a shared responsibility, so this includes our learnings at Microsoft, as well as guidance for customers and partners to be more resilient.
We hope you enjoy the conversation that follows.
Today, we'll be focusing on an Azure Front Door incident that impacted first-party Microsoft services. Within the Azure family, this impacted Azure DevOps and Azure Virtual Desktop, but it also impacted some LinkedIn and Microsoft 365 services. This was on the 5th of August, 2024. And so to cover this incident, I'd like to introduce our panel of speakers today, starting with Abhishek Tiwari, who is our vice president from the Azure networking team, as well as Mike Ziok, our partner director and service engineering manager from the Microsoft 365 team. Welcome both. Thank you for joining us today to talk through this incident. Abhishek, we'll start with you since this was an Azure Front Door incident. I was reading in the PIR that this incident only impacted first-party services that use AFD, but there are some external commercial customers that use AFD. Could you help us to understand the difference and clarify who was or wasn't impacted here?
Yeah, sure. To start with Azure Front Door is a distributed edge platform that provides global load balancing, WAF, and other protection functionality to our customer. This service is being used by both, as David, you mentioned, by our Azure external customers, as well as most of the Microsoft internal services. It's the same platform that's serving both the categories of customers. In this incident, it impacted only the first party services, especially the M365 and LinkedIn. And like any other services, this is because the front door is distributed different availability zones, and then the regression or this live side was in the availability zone that was serving the Microsoft 365 and some of the other critical Microsoft services.
Got it. That's a great starting point here. So if you're an external customer and you are consuming Azure Front Door services, you were not impacted. But if you're an external customer and you were consuming some of those internal Microsoft services that I mentioned, things like Virtual Desktop or Azure DevOps or Microsoft 365, then you could have been impacted. So that's a helpful distinction here. So Abhishek, what was the initial trigger event for this incident? We try not to talk about root causes, but what happened first that made this impactful?
Yeah, sure. So the initial trigger was, as I said, the front door is serving the Microsoft internal services, and the initial trigger was one of the Microsoft internal service making a configuration change to their specific Azure front door profile. Like any other customer, this config had a regression or a bug that caused the memory utilization on the servers that being serving the traffic for the critical Microsoft 1P services go on a very high memory utilization or consumption, hence triggering a regression in the overall available capacity for the Azure Front Door.
Got it. Okay, so there was a bug in that configuration file. Now, as we know, things are always true when it comes to incidents, right? Hardware has problems, software has bugs, people make mistakes. So software has bugs, we know that can happen. I believe we have our safe deployment practices to try to make sure that when a bug like that is introduced, it doesn't get rolled out across regions. But I understand in this case, that safe deployment process wasn't enough to stop this from being a multi-region incident. Could you help us to understand that a little bit?
Sure. Just to start with the distinction, this is like, you know, the customer configuration or the 1P, the changes, it's all go through the safe deployment practices for the Azure Front Door. In this case, also, the configuration done for the 1P service, the first party service, followed the SDP going through the three stages of the deployment. However, the validation checks we have before passing it to the next stage, there was our health signal didn't see the enough regression, or they didn't meet the thresholds that would stop this configuration flowing into the next stage. So the validation gaps allowed this configuration to proceed to the multiple stages, and hence it caused the multi-region outage. Like any major outage, it's usually like, you know, two failure modes. In the first failure mode, there was a bad configuration, and then there was another bug that like, you know, started having a storm of requests coming that like using more and more memory consumption that in the later stage caused a severe availability impact for the Azure Front Door services in this zone.
Got it. Okay, so we were treating kind of config as code. This did go through safe deployment like usual, but because of that kind of gray nature of the failure, it wasn't detected in those earlier phases.
Absolutely.
And you mentioned that was a gap in our validation, so we'll get to that when we cover our repair items. But now that we understand the issue, what happened on the day? So how did our people and systems respond? How did we detect this? How did we investigate this? And ultimately, how did we mitigate it during impact?
So this incident, like, you know, our internal alerting and health monitoring system caught this regression. So Azure Front Door and almost all our major first party services got their own internal alerts, including the M365. The way we did is to mitigate this issue, once our DRI got engaged, the right people and experts on the bridge, we ended up rolling back the offending configuration that was done by that particular internal Microsoft service. And once the config rollback was completed across the fleet, the issue was mitigated. So that's how we responded. Some of the first party services have responded with their own disaster recovery procedure, which Mike would cover it later. But that's overall the mitigation was rolling back the configuration that offended or regressed the available capacity.
Got it. Okay, so that's how we got customers back online. So now I'd love to pivot to our kind of learnings or repair items from the Azure Front Door perspective here. I know in the post-incident review, we listed first and foremost that we were going to fix that initial bug that caused the erroneous configuration file. I understand that's working with some internal partner teams. How's that going?
Yeah, that bug is fixed. The bad configuration file that caused the regression. So that bug is fixed. If a similar configuration chain gets deployed to it, we will not be hit that bug. So that bug is fixed. And then the other issue on the side that resulted in a storm of requests, that bug is also being addressed in a short term and would be released to all the client applications. So those two bugs are one is fixed and one is getting rolled out.
Got it. Okay, so that's helpful for this specific instance of what triggered the problem here. But what about more generally? We talked about validating the kind of resource overhead requirements for other similar internal configuration updates. So how are we going to protect against this kind of thing rather than this specific bug?
So there was, like, you know, as we mentioned, the root cause for this trigger, there was a validation gap. And then Azure Front Door has the health metrics that allows basically looking into the resource consumption, different type of metrics for the resource consumption, and then stopping the invalid configuration to propagate. We are enhancing our health metrics in a way that, like, you know, understands the memory consumption and few other metrics as part of learning we got from this live site. So we would be enhancing those metrics to ensure that our validation to stop these offending configs propagating further would be handled more maturely and better.
Got it. That's helpful to understand. You have to put a dollar in the root cause jar since you said it. So next up, we were talking about automatically disabling performance intensive operations. Is this something that we already have in place and we're extending, or this is a net new effort to look for kind of identifying those performance intensive operations in a more dynamic way?
We had a way of automatically disabling some of the configuration, specifically that results in a slow read or slow write request that, like, you know, hogging up the queue of our servers. So those checks were there, but it's, as we said, it's not enough. So we are having more checks that would automatically ensure that, like, you know, we block the tenant or request that causing this in this incident, specifically the high memory consumptions in the OS level. So we would be augmenting not just the memory, but the few of the gaps that we have identified, and that would ensure that we block it, those requests upfront in the platform, apart from the blocking the configuration to propagate to further stages. So this is in addition we would be doing in our platform.
Got it. That's great to understand. Now, I know in the preliminary post-incident review, we were talking about retry logic. And I noticed we've corrected that in our final post-incident review to say this wasn't actually a set of retries. This was a request storm, but there were individual requests here. So could you help us to understand that difference and then help us to understand the dynamic throttling repair that we mentioned in the PIR?
Yeah, the one of the gap in the Azure Front Door platform, we had like, you know, these like, you know, a way to handle whether it's a retry storms or a request storms, though those are like, you know, two categories. But we have a static limits based on understanding of our platform capacity to make sure the platform is always protected. In this live side, what happened because of the high memory consumptions, overall serving capacity of each server went way below our threshold. Hence, our server not able to handle the request storm that is coming, but still our threshold being super high. So suppose we were able to serve a 2x of the request. In this case, the memory consumption cost us to, you know, serve only X and hence didn't meet any of the threshold. By having a dynamic way of adjusting our policies threshold, as we are seeing in the resource consumptions by these requests or retries, would help us making sure even if we have missed the way, like, you know, some of the requests could consume our resources, would be still protected. So while we are, like, you know, immediately updating the static threshold, having a repair towards the dynamic throttling in the request storm would be helpful.
Great. I could see how that would have helped here. Now, we talked about safe deployment early on, and we've discussed a couple of different approaches to this in the PIR. So firstly, we're talking about augmenting those safe deployment practices with additional health signals to enable some kind of automatic rollback. And then separately, we talked about an automatic fallback to the last known good configuration. Could you help us to understand these two repairs? That they sound the same to me, but evidently they're different.
Yeah. So just to say, this is not the new platform enhancement that we are doing, David. We support today of having a set of health signals that stops the propagation, and based on the degradation or the health of the environment, like which consists not just the individual server, but a overall impact on the availability of the Azure Front Door, we go back to the last known good. So while the stopping the configuration is a first step, but if we see it's a high severity impact to our availability, we do the automatic rollback to the last known good configuration. So they're part of the same steam, but two distinct the steps that we take. We are using the same platform to augment additional health signal that as part of came, like, you know, from the learning from this particular live sites, including the memory consumptions and the way our server capacity could be reduced in certain stress scenarios. So we would be augmenting those health signal, putting into the both stopping the automatic propagation of the config, and also if it's the impacting the overall SLA of Azure Front Door, doing the last known good configuration rollback automatically.
Cool. Okay, that's great to hear. So AFD is doing a lot of different things to protect against both this specific incident and more generally this class of problem. So thank you for running us through that, Abhishek. Mike, I'd love to turn our attention to you. I know that you're here to represent the Microsoft 365 side of things. What did impact look and feel like, and did that vary depending on which Microsoft 365 service we're talking about here?
Yeah, so great question. The impact did vary. Azure Front Door provides in and of itself a very resilient set of capabilities, but given the scale of Microsoft 365 and the critical nature of some of the capabilities, we also have another service that we rely on to provide us with that layer 7 proxy support. And so ultimately we had a varying set of implementations, and we are on a constant path of improvement. So for example, the Exchange service took advantage of that dynamically. Teams recently implemented resilience using this secondary capability, and we had about 5 to 7 minutes of impact. Ultimately, the SharePoint OneDrive service went back to its origin endpoint, but there was some secondary impact to things like thumbnails. So primary services such as read-write of your documents would have largely been unaffected, but things like thumbnails would have been impacted. There was some secondary impact, for example, to some images showing up properly within Teams, but largely Teams recovered from this very, very quickly. in terms of operation. There actually is a great document provided by the Azure team, which hopefully we can link in here, in terms of resilience for Azure Front Door that provides a set of best practices. But again, our impact was driven in part by whether a service had fully onboarded to a set of resilient capabilities or required some manual intervention in its action.
Got it. Thank you for the summary there, Mike. It sounds like this was some good example of Microsoft 365 services taking advantage of that Azure resilience. And even where there were, you know, additional failures, it sounds like there was some graceful degradation that had impacted some less critical elements of the services. So that's great to hear. Having said that, are there any relevant learnings or repair items from any of the Microsoft 365 services in response to this?
Yeah, I mean, as a general overarching principle, you never want an engineering team to have to get engaged to invoke a resilience act. You want your services to be active, and you want them to be able to dynamically route traffic in the event. So for example, the team service did require some intervention, although minor in terms of overall impact. There's still an opportunity to improve there. We're continuing to onboard services into our resilient function. Sort of think of Azure Front Door as a very resilient capability, but we want to make sure there's a side door so the services continue to operate. And so ultimately, where we did not have full dynamic and active modeling, so it required intervention, or we needed to withstand the outage and then recover, we are continuing to onboard services into that resilient set of capabilities that we have developed internally to augment the Azure Front Door service.
Great. Okay, that's good to hear. Thank you for covering that, Mike. Lastly, I wanted to briefly touch on our communications during this incident, since I represent the Azure comms team here. We were able to post up using the Azure status page, which is our public non-authenticated experience, particularly in the early phases of this incident when we weren't entirely sure which services or which regions were impacted. Ultimately, as we kind of figured out more about the issue, we realized that the impact of Azure was relatively minimal, just being Azure DevOps and Azure Virtual Desktop. So we were able to send targeted communications just to those impacted customers who had Azure Virtual Desktop being impacted. And we continue to provide updates on that public status page to talk about the wider impact to other Microsoft services that rely on it. So we feel pretty good from a comms perspective. It could have been quicker, but as far as the content of the comms updates themselves, we were happy with the transparency and were able to kind of explain to customers what was going on until it was mitigated.
Thank you for watching this Azure Incident Retrospective. At the scale of which our cloud operates at, incidents are inevitable.
Just as Microsoft is always learning and improving, we hope our customers and partners can learn from these too and provide a lot of reliability guidance through the Azure Well-Architected Framework.
To ensure that you get posted incident reviews after an outage and invites to join these live stream Q&A sessions, please ensure that you have Azure Service Health Alerts set up.
We really focused on being as transparent as possible and showing up and being accountable after these major incidents.
Whether it's an outage, a security, or a privacy event, Microsoft is investing heavily in these events to ensure that we earn, maintain, and at times rebuild your trust. Thanks for joining us.